Next question number 125. The QRS complex in a standard ECG, P wave, Q, R, S, T wave, U wave. So this if you observe the standard ECG, the Q, this wave is a Q wave, which is negative wave, and this is R wave, positive wave, and this is S wave, and this one will become the T wave. In this, the QRS complex in the standard ECG represents, that was the question. In the first option, they asked the repolarization of ventricles. Actually, QRS complex represents the depolarization of ventricles. T wave represents the repolarization of ventricles. P wave represents the depolarization of atria. So repolarization of atria wave, that wave is not represented in the standard ECG. So QRS complex represents the depolarization of ventricles. Depolarization of ventricles, depolarization stage is the stage which is not same as the previous stage. So if you observe 125, that depolarization of ventricles was given in fourth option. The QRS complex, it represents the depolarization of ventricles. That is an answer. So fourth option is the correct option for 125. Let us move to the next question, 127. So in 127th question, they asked which of the following refer to correct example of organisms which have evolved due to changes in the environment brought about by anthropogenic action. This word is very important. Anthropogenic action. So because of anthropogenic action, which one is correct? That's what they're asking. In the first option, they gave the finch birds of Darwin. And in the second one, they gave herbicide resistant weeds. And in the third one, they gave drug resistant eukaryotes. And in the D, they gave man-created breeds of domesticated animals like dogs. This was given. So this is man-made. This is actually man-made. So these are all the four options given there. So if you observe the Darwin finches of Galapagos Island, you know, 16 islands observed by the Darwin, and he explored the flora and fauna and observe the finches. That's why the finch birds became so much popular, and we are calling them as Darwin finches. So Darwin finches is obviously not because of anthropogenic action. Just Darwin observed them. It is not because of the Darwin. So obviously Darwin finches won't comes under anthropogenic action. And the herbicide resistant weeds followed by the drug resistant eukaryotes. You know, if you apply the drugs, then only the resistance capacity will be known. And even the creation, human being by different types of breedings, like inbreeding, outbreeding, crossbreeding, you know, different types of breeding techniques are there. And because of these breeding techniques, human being created different types of animals and the domesticated animals. So many breeds of the dogs also prepared are just because of the human activities only. So anthropogenic actions means B, C, D. These three will comes under anthropogenic action with reference to 127, and it was clearly mentioned in the fourth option that B, C, D, remaining three options are not mentioning the B, C, D clearly. So in the first option only D, second option only A, third option A and C given. So in the fourth option only B, C, D given. So students will definitely will go to the fourth option. That's all about 127. And the next question, if you observe the next question, 128 is relatively very easy question. Direct question from the CBSE test book in evolution. If you observe the embryological support for evolution, embryological support for evolution. Students, don't confuse. They are not asking who gave the embryological support for evolution. They are asking embryological support for evolution was disapproved by. This is very important. Who disapproved it? Disapproved by. This is very important. You know, embryological support, you know, Ernst Haeckel, he conducted so many experiments regarding the embryology. So if you observe, embryological support for evolution was given by, in the first option, Oparin, scientist name given. In the second option, the first option, Oparin, very famous scientist in the explanation of chemical evolution of life. And in the second option, they mentioned Carl Ernest von Baer, obviously a great scientist who disapproved the statement given by the scientist, so called Ernest Haeckel. And the third one, Alfred Russel Wallace. And fourth one, Charles Darwin. So among these four statements, who disapproved that embryological support of evolution was disapproved by this Wern. If you observe the Baer, von Baer, he is nothing but Carl Ernest von Baer, and he disapproved the embryological statements given by Ernest Haeckel. And that's all about 128. If you observe the next question, next question, 131, which of the following would help in prevention of diuresis? If you observe 131, which of the following would help in prevention of diuresis? This is very important. Prevention of diuresis. Diuresis is nothing but having more water in urine. Diuresis. And the hormone which prevents this diuresis is anti-diuretic hormone. That is the reason why it is called anti-diuretic hormone, also called vasopressin. It is also called vasopressin. So in the 131, if you observe, the first one, decrease in secretion of renin by the juxtaglomerular cells, decrease in secretion of renin by juxtaglomerular JG cells, that was given in the first option. Second one, more water reabsorption due to under secretion of ADH. No, if ADH secretion is not there, what happens? There will be nobody to reabsorb the water. I mean to say, if ADH is not there, ADH is not influencing the renal tubules to take the water. So more water goes out. But here the question is asking who prevents the diuresis. So second one is also not the correct one. And third one, reabsorption of Na+. This is very important. Reabsorption of Na+ and water from the renal tubules due to aldosterone. Yes, because of the reabsorption of Na+, water holding capacity also increases and is produced by the aldosterone. You know, adrenal cortex produces number of hormones. Among those number of hormones, the mineralocorticoid called aldosterone plays an important role. And the Na+ reabsorption also takes place because of this aldosterone from the lateral parts of the tubules, renal tubules. So third one is correct. And fourth one, if you observe, atrial natriuretic factor, ANF, which causes vasoconstriction. No, atrial natriuretic factor, it is not the factor which is going to perform that particular event called vasoconstriction. And this ANF is produced by, you know, the wall of the atrium. Okay, so if you observe the 131, among the given four statements, who is going to prevent the diuresis? Who is going to prevent the diuresis? More water is not allowing to go out from the body because of the third event. Why? Because Na+, it holds more water. Also because of the third event, inside the body water volume increases, not in the urine. So 131, third option is the correct option.
ఇంక 20 క్వశ్చన్స్ ఉన్నాయి.
నెక్స్ట్ క్వశ్చన్ నెంబర్ 132. ఇఫ్ యూ అబ్జర్వ్, ఇట్స్ ఎ మ్యాచింగ్ క్వశ్చన్. ది ఫస్ట్ వన్ గివెన్ థలసీమియా, and second one given hemophilia HAE, and third one phenylketonuria PKU, and fourth one sickle cell anemia. And in the opposite column they gave the autosomal or allosomal pattern of inheritance with reference to these disorders. If you observe thalassemia, it's an X-linked given. No, it is not X-linked. Thalassemia is an autosomal linked, which is associated with 11th chromosome and 16th chromosome. You know, hemophilia, three types are there: hemophilia A, hemophilia B, hemophilia C. But hemophilia A is more common and is X-linked recessive disorder. So this is X-linked recessive disorder. Phenylketonuria, this is an autosomal recessive. They gave autosomal dominant. So it is not autosomal dominant, it is autosomal recessive. Sickle cell anemia, which is nothing but autosomal recessive. And of course, it is associated with the chromosome 11, which was also given clearly to the students. So if we observe, these three were wrongly given. Only this was correctly given. So for 132, fourth option is the correct match. Remaining three are mismatches. That's all about 132. Let us move to the 133. They asked a question with reference to the productivity. In relation to the gross primary productivity and net primary productivity of an ecosystem, which one of the following statements is correct? In the first one, they are saying there is no relationship between gross primary productivity and net primary productivity. How there won't be no relation? Definitely there will be a relation. So this statement is wrong. And second one, gross primary productivity is always less than net primary productivity. No, in fact, opposite is correct. And third one, if we observe, the gross primary productivity is more than net primary productivity, and this is correct. And if we observe the fourth one, gross primary productivity and net primary productivity is one and same. No, this is also not correct. Gross primary productivity is nothing but the rate of new organic matter what the plants will produce. So it is always more than the net primary productivity, and the energy which is transferred is always less if you compared the higher trophic level with the lower trophic level. What I mean to say, the energy availability which is there at the lower trophic level is always more when compared with the higher trophic level or the next trophic level. And they also follows the 10% law or rule, you know, Lindemann's trophic efficiency rule. So now if you observe the 133, third option is the correct option. Let us move to the next question, 134. In 134 question, they asked a nice question with reference to the statements of the breathing and exchange of gases. Low PCO2, they're asking to find out the wrong statement. This is very important. Wrong statement with reference to the transport of oxygen. They're asking to find out the wrong statement with reference to the transport of oxygen. If you observe the 134, they're asking low PCO2 in alveoli favors the formation of low PCO2 in alveoli favors the formation of oxyhemoglobin. Yes, if PCO2 is less, PO2 will be high. If PO2 is more, hemoglobin shows more affinity to the oxygen and it will bind more with the oxygen, forming the oxyhemoglobin compound. Similarly, if carbon dioxide concentration is high, hemoglobin binds with the carbon dioxide. But if hemoglobin concentration, binds more with the oxygen, we can say that oxygen concentration is more. So if low PCO2, it means high PO2, if there, it binds with the hemoglobin and forming the oxyhemoglobin. So that statement is absolutely correct. And second one, binding of oxygen with the hemoglobin is mainly related to the partial pressure of oxygen. That's what just now I told, mainly related to the partial pressure of oxygen. If oxygen concentration is more, something like what we have seen or what we will see generally in alveoli, more binding of hemoglobin with oxygen takes place, resulting in the formation of oxyhemoglobin. So this statement is also correct. And third one, partial pressure of CO2 can interfere with the oxygen binding with the hemoglobin. Yes, if partial pressure of CO2 is more, definitely, or if the PCO2 is present, it definitely interferes with oxygen binding with the hemoglobin. That is nothing but Bohr effect. And reverse is also correct, which is Helden effect. Don't forget it. So third statement is also correct. And fourth one, high H plus concentration in the alveoli favors the formation of oxyhemoglobin. No, it is wrong statement. High H plus ions means obviously PCO2 also will be more. So, but they are mentioning, they are asking, they gave oxyhemoglobin. So that is wrong statement. High H plus ions won't favor the formation of oxyhemoglobin. So this is a wrong statement. Remaining three statements are perfect with reference to breathing and exchange of gases. That's all about 134th question. Next question, question number 135. Once again from Human Health and Disease. The infectious stage of Plasmodium that enters human body. The infectious stage of Plasmodium. The infectious stage of Plasmodium that enters the human body is number 1 male gametocytes, number 2 trophozoites, and number 3 sporozoites. Number 3 sporozoites and fourth one female gametocytes. So in this, the infectious stages, they are very important with reference to the Plasmodium or for any parasite, even something like amoeba histolytica and even filaria, which is nothing but filariasis caused by Eukarya, and ascariasis, which is caused by Ascaris lumbricoides, even Dracunculus. Like that, different types of parasites are there. For all parasites, infective stages are very important for perpetuation of the life cycle, for continuation of the life cycle. So the infectious stages of Plasmodium are nothing but the sporozoites. They are nothing but, they are not the male gametocytes or female gametocytes, not trophozoites also. In fact, sporozoites, later they will become the trophozoites. Trophy means food or growth, you know, they are the feeding stages. Sporozoites are the infective stages with reference to Plasmodium. So the correct answer is third option with reference to 135. Let us move to the next question, 136. I think it's from disorders. Yes, it is from disorders. If you observe the presence of which of the following conditions in the urine, the presence of which of the following conditions in the urine indicative of diabetes mellitus. Diabetes mellitus, you know, there are two types of diabetes mellitus are there. Diabetes mellitus, diabetes insipidus. Two types are there. You know, insulin dependent diabetes mellitus is one type. Non-insulin dependent diabetes mellitus is another type. Two types of diabetes are there. But here I am talking about diabetes mellitus. Why? Because it was given in the question. I restrict myself to the diabetes mellitus. Mellitus is nothing but the sweet bread, honey. It means the urine will become very sweet for that person, or for the person, or in the person who is suffering from diabetes. Not in all persons. The person who is suffering from diabetes mellitus, in generally, that person eliminates glucose, also sugar, through his urine. That is the reason why the urine will become sweet. That is the reason why the name was given as mellitus, M-E-L-L-I-T-U-S, diabetes mellitus. Let us move to the question. The first one, which of the following conditions in the urine indicates diabetes? The first one, renal calculi and hyperglycemia. Renal calculi and hyperglycemia. Second one is uremia and ketonuria. Ketonuria. And third one is uremia as usual and renal calculi. Third option. And fourth option, ketonuria, N-U-R-I-A. I want to see whether ketonuria was given or not. That's what I am checking there. And glycosuria, G-L-Y-C-O, glycosuria. See this, renal calculi. Renum means kidney, calculus means stone, which are also called kidney stones because of citrates and oxalates. If they accumulate in the kidney, especially the kidney stones will accumulate in the calyx region of the kidney, especially generally they will accumulate in the calyx region, and sometimes depending on the size of the stone, they may block the ureter also, which causes the shooting pain, unbearable pain, patient not even walk properly. And the renal calculi is clearly evident in the form of vomitings also. Vomiting sensation is also seen in renal calculi. Person can't bear the pain with reference to the renal calculi. And hyperglycemia is nothing but having more glucose. See, this is quite unrelated to the first option, to the question. and second one uremia and ketonuria. Ketonuria is related to diabetes mellitus. Why? Because ketone bodies will be released by the person through his urine when he is suffering from diabetes mellitus, and uremia is not the condition generally seen. And third one, uremia, renal calculi, they won't come, they already I told you. And fourth one, ketonuria, having ketone bodies in the urine, and glycosuria, having glucose. Glycogen undergoes breakdown to release the glucose. Glycogenolysis, breakdown of glycogen, which gives the glucose, and that glucose goes out through urine. So fourth option is the correct option with reference to 136. Let us move to the next question. Question number 138 students. It's a matching type of question from the animal kingdom. Very nice. In the column 1, they mentioned 6 to 15 pairs of gill slits were given in the first one, and second one, heterocercal caudal fin. Heterocercal, heterocercal caudal fin. This is caudal fin, heterocercal caudal fin. And third one, air bladder. They have not mentioned whether it is present or absent, so we have to consider it as present. And the last one, poisonous sting. So these are the characters given in the column 1. In the column 2, they ask it to match with the concerned organism or group. If you observe, 6 to 15 pairs of gills are present in cyclostomes, which was given in the second option. Cyclostomes, 6 to 15 pairs of gill slits are present. Cyclostomes, best example. See, cyclostome. Cyclo means cyclic, round. Stome means mouth. Round mouth having a ring-like mouth having animals. They are nothing but cyclostomes. Petromyzon, myxine, best example. And these are parasitic. Petromyzon is nothing but, it sucks the blood from the living fish, whereas myxine is necrophagous, it takes the flesh. Petromyzon is sanguivorous and myxine is necrophagous. And heterocercal caudal fin is generally present in sharks. I will show you. See, this is heterocercal caudal fin. I have not represented the shark, I have represented the caudal fin only, tail fin. The heterocercal caudal fin, that is the characteristic feature of the chondrichthyes, which are nothing but sharks. I will write here, no problem. So it is seen in sharks, chondrichthyes. Chondri means cartilage, ichthys means fish. That is the reason why the study of fish is called ichthyology, and study of reptiles is called herpetology, like so. Okay, air bladder is generally present in the options. Osteichthyes, it is present in osteichthyes. Osteichthyes are nothing but the bony fish, where air bladder is present. If air bladder is present, there is some advantage for the animal. If air bladder is absent, animal has to continuously swim to avoid sinking. If air bladder is present, animal can maintain its balance. No need to swim continuously. Fish has to swim, but continuous swimming is not that much required if air bladder is present, which is also called swim bladder. And it produces a gas, so it is also called gas bladder sometimes. And poisonous sting is present for stingray, which is nothing but trigon, which was given in the first option. Poisonous sting is present for stingray. So sharks and rays, there are some closely related, though some differences are there. Anyhow, if you correctly match for 138, second option will become the correct option for 138. And let us move to the 139. If you observe the 139, flippers of penguins, penguins and dolphins, okay, delphinus. Flippers of penguins and dolphins are the examples of first option, natural selection, second one, adaptive radiation, third one is convergent evolution, and fourth one is industrial melanism. Natural selection, which was explained by Darwin, and he quoted Finches. So that is not the answer. Adaptive radiation, the animal will migrate to different areas and they acquire different types of adaptations in order to adjust to the environmental conditions which are prevailing there. So the adaptive radiation, and this adaptive radiation is also not the answer, but it is an extreme character in the evolution. Without adaptive radiation, we can't explain evolution. And the third one is convergent evolution, which can be best explained with the analogous organs. The organs what given in the question paper, they are analogous organs with different origin, but generally they will perform a common function. You see the flippers of penguins and dolphins, generally common function is swimming. Okay, and fourth one is industrial melanism, which was explained by Bernard Kettlewell by taking Biston Butylaria moths. No, gray color moths and black color moths were explained by Bernard Kettlewell, and that also won't comes under the answer. So for 139, convergent evolution, if you observe the third option, which was given as the convergent evolution, that is the correct answer for 139. Third option is the correct option. Next question 140. Snow blindness in Antarctic region. Snow blindness. 140. Snow blindness in Antarctic region is snow blindness in Antarctic region. Okay, no problem. I can write here. Snow blindness in the Antarctic region. Snow blindness in Antarctic region is due to, number one, damage to retina caused by infrared rays. Number two, freezing of fluids in the eye because of low temperature, given in the second option. And third option, inflammation of the cornea due to high dose of UVB radiation. And fourth one, high reflection of light from the snow, which is quite unrelated. If you observe the options, the students can easily sort out. And inflammation of the cornea due to high dose of UVB radiation. UVB radiation causes damage to cornea, and inflammation of cornea is observed, and it may leads to snow blindness also. So the remaining three options are quite unrelated to the given one. Students can easily come to the conclusion that third option is the right option for 140th one. And if you observe, generally, you know, the cornea absorbs the UVB radiation. You can understand very easily, because of that high dose of UVB radiation, so many problems, something like even cataract is also observed. And let us move to the next question, 142. The process of growth is maximum. Students, generally, you know, there are two types of curves will be there. Exponential growth curve and the logistic growth curve or sigmoid growth curve. And of course, both are ultimately limited by carrying capacity. The student shouldn't miss this point. Everybody or most of the students will think carrying capacity generally, okay, where the carrying capacity is applicable, whether here carrying capacity is represented with capital K, where it is applicable, whether this here it is applicable or here it is applicable, where it is applicable, and all the students will concentrate on the carrying capacity with reference to this type of curve rather than the exponential growth curve. But you have to remember that even exponential growth curve, carrying capacity play an important role. Carrying capacity plays an important role even in the case of exponential growth curve also. But anyhow, here the question is not with reference to carrying capacity. As I have represented the graphs, I am explaining. You know, 142, the process of growth is maximum during the log phase. You know, the graph is growing, increasing. So the growth is maximum during this phase. So not in the dormancy, not in the lag phase. The name itself indicates it's a lag. Senescence is quite unrelated to this growth. So 142, log phase is the correct one, and this is exponential one, and this exponential one is not that much realistic when compared with this sigmoid growth curve pattern, whatever it may be. So here, even though no need to represent these two diagrams in order to explain that 142 question, but sigmoid growth curve is generally more realistic. Why? Because when we compare these two, food resources are unlimited here. Food resources are limited in nature. Generally, food resources will be limited sometimes sooner or later. So this will be more realistic when compared with the first one. Anyhow, if you restrict to the question, the answer will become log phase. So log phase will become log, will become the answer for the second one. That's all about 142. And let us move to the next question, 147. It's a very simple question. Okay, just by taking at a glance, the students come to immediate conclusion that, okay, 7 million. Why? Because Robert May, according to the Robert May, the global species diversity is about 7 million. It's a direct textbook statement. It's completely memory-based one. You have to remember so many memory-based aspects are there in the biodiversity, like number of birds in Amazon, number of amphibians in Amazon, so many numerical aspects are there. But you know, the paper setter was very quite kind enough and simply gave a very nice question. According to Robert May, the global species diversity is simply 7 million. So first option is the correct option with reference to 147. 150 kuda.